hermanos de Sion, Pastor Cristo, es para nosotros un grande privilegio alabar el poderoso nombre de Cristo Jesús. Church of Zion, it is such a privilege to be able to worship the name of Jesus. The Word of God says in the book of Acts, chapter 4, hallelujah, and verse 12, it says, there is salvation neither in any other, for there is no name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. Hechos 4:12 dice, y en ningún otro hay salvación, porque no hay otro nombre bajo el cielo dado a los hombres en que podamos ser salvos. Hoy en este día es, hermanos, para nosotros un grande gozo alabar el poderoso nombre de Cristo Jesús. What a joy it is to worship the amazing and the powerful name of Jesus. Let's go before the Lord in prayer. Cristo Jesús, dedicamos, Señor, este tiempo de adoración y de alabanza. Oh, Señor, que tu Espíritu Santo satura cada corazón. Aleluya, derrama, Señor, de tu presencia en cada hogar, en este lugar, Señor. Oh, gracias, Señor. Aleluya, we commit all these things before you, God, giving you praise and all of the honor and all of the glory. Why don't we worship the Lord with the song in Spanish? Hallelujah. Vamos a alabar al Señor con esa alabanza que dice, gloria sea el nombre de Dios.
Gloria sea tu nombre, mi Dios. Gloria sea tu nombre, mi Dios.
with life. We woke up, Lord, with the hope and the promises, Lord, and the goodness, Lord, of who you are, of every declaration, Lord, of your word. We thank you, giving you, God, all of the honor and all of the glory and all of the praise. Oh, hallelujah, in Jesus' name, in Jesus' name. Vamos a, hermanos, adorar al Señor Jesucristo, declarando nuestro deseo siempre estar cerca al Señor. Yo quiero estar cerca a mi Rey. Such a privilege to be with you this morning, and let us just open our hearts, because I believe the Lord has a beautiful word for each and every one of us. In Jesus' name, our Pastor Leo Maffei, with us. God bless you.
Hermano, paz de Cristo. Pueden sentarse. Es para mí un alto privilegio venir ante ustedes trayendo un mensaje de la palabra de Dios. Y como dice la Biblia, ¿verdad? Las misericordias de Dios son nuevas cada mañana. Cada mañana que despertamos es una nueva oportunidad que Dios nos ha dado de servirle a Él, de darle la honra y la gloria a Él, porque Él es bueno, porque para siempre es su misericordia y porque nuestra vida, hermanos, está en las manos de Dios. Y todo lo que habremos logrado, realizado o hecho es únicamente por la voluntad de Dios. Y a Él sea la honra y la gloria y la suprema alabanza. Alaba a Dios, porque el día de ayer Dios me concedió cumplir años. No lo voy a decir cuántos, pero sí, cumplí años, hermanos. Y cuando hago una reflexión de mi vida, cuando hago un inventario de mi vida, yo puedo ver la mano de Dios que fue conmigo en cada faceta, cada área de mi vida. Desde que era niño, hermano, la mano de Dios fue conmigo. Y me ha bendecido, ¿verdad?, en una manera innumerable a través de, ¿verdad?, de mi educación, mis trabajos. Ustedes, hermanos, verdad que para mí es un privilegio ser pastor de una iglesia tan hermosa, tan preciosa, de unos seres tan hermosos, verdad, que son ustedes, y para mí es un privilegio servirles en el nombre del Señor Jesucristo. En esta mañana voy a hablarles acerca de la necesidad del bautismo, y alabamos a Dios porque después del culto de la 12, probablemente como la 1, vamos a presenciar dos bautismos, pero únicamente las familias, la familia Chávez y la familia Vera van a estar aquí dentro del templo por el protocolo, hermanos, del gobierno. Pero en este día tenemos dos bautismos, ¿verdad? Y al Señor sea la gloria. Pero leemos en el libro de los Hechos, capítulo 10, miramos la narración de un hombre llamado Cornelio. Este hombre era un comandante general romano que tenía bajo su disposición o bajo su autoridad 100 soldados. Pero había algo muy peculiar de este hombre que no era como los demás individuos. Dice la Biblia que este hombre era piadoso, temeroso de Dios. Él con toda su casa era dadivoso, daba limosnas. Él oraba siempre, ayunaba con frecuencia, tenía muy buen testimonio, una excelente reputación y vivía una vida ejemplar. En el pueblo era conocido, hermanos, como un hombre, ¿verdad?, de alto calibre, un hombre, ¿verdad?, que era un ejemplo para todos ellos. Y si alguien examinara a este hombre, a Cornelio, y desde la perspectiva humana, este hombre ya era salvo. Este hombre, por su manera de vivir, según los humanos, este hombre estaba bien con Dios. Y conforme, ¿verdad?, a la idea humana, este hombre estaba completo y realizado, y como que nada le hacía falta, hablando espiritualmente. Pero esto no es verdad, porque la palabra de Dios especifica que el único que tiene la facultad y la autoridad y el poder para dar la salvación y el perdón de pecados es Dios. Dios, hermanos, es el único que nos puede dar la salvación. Nosotros no podemos hacerlo por nosotros mismos. Y por eso en Efesios 2, el 8, 9 dice: porque por gracias sois salvos por medio de la fe. Y esto no de vosotros, pues es un don de Dios. No por obras, para que nadie se gloríe. Fíjense cómo dice ahí: no por obras, para que nadie se gloríe. Entonces Cornelio, él no conocía el proceso correcto de la salvación, como mucha gente en este mundo cree que van a ser salvos por sus obras. Y tal vez sí haya mucha gente buena, pero eso en sí no lo va a hacer, no los puede hacer salvos. Pero por eso a Cornelio le envía un ángel quien le dice: Cornelio, tus oraciones y tus limosnas han subido para memoria delante de Dios. Envía pues ahora hombres a Joppe y haz venir a Simón, el que tiene por sobrenombre Pedro. Este posa en casa de cierto Simón Curtidor, que tiene su casa junto al mar. Y fíjese lo que dice, lo que le dice el ángel a Cornelio: él te dirá lo que es necesario que hagas. En otras palabras, Cornelio, Dios ha visto tu buena conducta, Dios ha visto en la forma espléndida que has vivido, tu vida ejemplar. Pero Cornelio, te hace falta algo, y para eso tienes que mandar a traer a Simón Pedro, y él te va a decir lo que tienes que hacer. Entonces Pedro, hermanos, o más bien Cornelio manda a traer a Pedro, y cuando llegan los mensajeros, hermanos, a la casa de Cornelio, ya Dios le había avisado a Pedro que él había enviado unos hombres y que Pedro fuera con ellos, que no tuviera temor. Entonces arriba Pedro a la casa de Cornelio, quien le cuenta su experiencia con el ángel de Dios. Ya el Señor había preparado, hermanos, al apóstol Pedro para que no tuviese temor y fuera a la casa de Cornelio. Llega, ¿verdad?, Pedro con Cornelio, y abre su boca Pedro y empieza a contarle a Cornelio el brillante y estupendo ministerio del Señor Jesucristo. De cómo el Señor Jesús de Nazaret, teniendo el poder del Espíritu Santo, anduvo haciendo bienes, sanando a los oprimidos por el diablo, porque Dios estaba con él. ¿Verdad? Una de las cosas del Señor Jesucristo, hermanos, su ministerio fue un ministerio hermoso, brillante, un ministerio, hermanos, que era de esperanza, de consuelo, un ministerio, ¿verdad?, en el cual él ayudaba a la gente, sanaba a los enfermos, daba de comer a los pobres. Hermanos, era algo magnífico, hermanos, el ministerio del Señor Jesucristo. Y eso le trata de relatar Pedro a Cornelio, porque Cornelio no había oído de Jesucristo. Entonces le dice Pedro a Cornelio, pero el Señor Jesucristo fue arrestado, fue crucificado, pero al tercer día Dios lo levantó de los muertos. Y luego Pedro le dice algo muy, muy especial a Cornelio en Hechos 10:43. Dice: de ese dan testimonio todos los profetas, que todos los que creyesen recibirán perdón de pecados por su nombre, por su nombre. Entonces lo que era importante aquí, ¿verdad?, era el ministerio de Jesús, lo que él había hecho, pero la misión de Jesús, que era de salvar al hombre de sus pecados, y sobre todo debería ser en el nombre del Señor Jesucristo. Mientras Pedro hablaba, hermanos, a Cornelio, a su familia y sus amigos, hablaba, hermanos, predicaba, dice la Biblia que el Espíritu Santo cayó, y Cornelio y sus familiares y amigos recibieron el Espíritu Santo y hablaron en lenguas, magnificando a Dios. El grupo, la comisión que venía con Pedro, se quedaron perplejos, se quedaron sorprendidos, porque Cornelio y su familia, sus amigos, no eran judíos. Y ellos no se imaginaban, hermanos, que la salvación era para todo el mundo, no únicamente para los judíos, sino que la salvación es para todos nosotros, los gentiles, los mexicanos, los cubanos, los puertorriqueños, los chinos, japoneses. Bueno, porque de tal manera amó Dios al mundo, dice la palabra de Dios, Juan 3:16. Entonces los judíos tenían esta noción errónea de que la salvación únicamente era para ellos nomás. Pero entonces cuando Dios, hermanos, a través de Jesucristo abre las puertas, abre la salvación para todo el mundo, hermanos, fue algo hermoso, especialmente para nosotros, los gentiles, los que no somos judíos. Entonces los hermanos que venían con Pedro se quedan atónitos, porque dicen: ¿cómo es posible que Dios haya escogido a estos no judíos hablando en lenguas, verdad? Entonces se quedan perplejos, pero es que Dios le estaba diciendo: hey, yo vine hablando, verdad, como Jesucristo, yo vine por todo el mundo, porque el Hijo del Hombre vino a buscar a salvar lo que se había perdido. Hermanos, alabamos a Dios en esta mañana, porque la salvación es para nosotros y para todo el mundo. Al Señor sea la honra y la gloria, y podemos ver su amor, su misericordia, su bondad, y el hecho de que Dios no hace excepción en personas. La salvación es para todo el mundo, ¿verdad? Y no importa si el hombre o la mujer, ¿verdad?, sean de color amarillo como los chinos, o cafecitos como nosotros latinos, ¿verdad? A Dios no le importa, a Dios le interesa, hermanos, si el hombre, ¿verdad?, es bajo de estatura, o es alto, o es fornido, sea lo que sea, aleluya, cada persona es importante ante los ojos de Dios. Al Señor sea la gloria, la suprema alabanza, hermanos. Y por eso, ¿verdad?, cuando Pedro mira que el Espíritu Santo cayó sobre Cornelio y sobre sus familiares, Pedro dice: ¿puede alguno impedir el agua para que no sean bautizados estos que han recibido el Espíritu Santo también como nosotros? Y dice la Biblia: y mandó bautizarles en el nombre del Señor Jesús. Entonces, lo que le hacía falta a Cornelio era oír la palabra de Dios, oír el evangelio y oír la verdad, ¿verdad? Lo que le hacía falta a Cornelio era creer en el Señor Jesucristo como su Salvador, arrepentirse y bautizarse en el nombre del Señor Jesucristo. Porque la salvación y el perdón de pecados es únicamente a través del Señor Jesucristo. Ese es el único método, no hay otro método, no hay otra filosofía, no hay otro plan, no hay ningún otro método, hermanos, porque dice la Biblia en Hechos 4:12: y en ningún otro hay salvación. No hay salvación en Buda, ni en nadie, ni en José Smith, en absolutamente en nadie, ni en ningún ángel. Únicamente en el Señor Jesucristo, y en ningún otro hay salvación, porque no hay otro nombre bajo el cielo dado a los hombres en el cual podamos ser salvos. Lo que le hacía falta a Cornelio, hermanos, era finalmente ser bautizado en el nombre del Señor Jesucristo. Y así, a través, hermanos, del bautismo, aleluya, Cornelio, hermanos, él, sus pecados fueron perdonados, y él tuvo la entrada a la salvación, a la vida eterna. Y por eso Jesús dijo: yo soy el camino, yo soy la verdad y la vida, nadie viene al Padre sino por mí. Entonces, hermanos, el único que tiene el poder para salvarnos, hermanos, es el Señor Jesucristo. Y finalmente Pedro voció: arrepentíos y bautícese cada uno de vosotros en el nombre de Jesucristo para perdón de los pecados y recibiréis el don del Espíritu Santo. Y esta salvación es para usted que me está escuchando, viendo a través del internet. Si usted no ha sido bautizado en el nombre de Jesucristo, usted todavía no es salvo. Si usted no ha sido bautizado en nombre de Jesucristo, todavía sus pecados no han sido perdonados. Aleluya. Todavía su nombre no ha sido escrito en el libro de la vida. Porque dice la Biblia, hermanos, que se van a abrir el Señor, Dios, ¿verdad? Va a abrir los libros. Uno es el libro de la vida, el otro es el libro de las obras. Pero nosotros, hermanos, por la gracia de Dios, el día que fuimos bautizados, nuestro nombre fue escrito en el libro de la vida. Y quisiera decirle a usted, oyente, ¿verdad?, que está mirando, que todavía no le sirve a Dios, busque a Dios, acérquese a Dios, porque Dios le quiere dar la salvación y la vida eterna únicamente a través del nombre del Señor Jesucristo. Amén. Enseguida vamos a recibir al ministro Leo Maffei, asistente pastor, que él sigue con el mensaje en inglés. Amén.
Hermanos, Pastor Cristo, qué hermoso privilegio es estar una vez más alabando el nombre de Cristo Jesús. I mean, what a beautiful privilege that is for each and every one of us to be able to worship the living God. We're thankful to God for our pastor, that the Lord has blessed him with another year of life. And we're thankful for all the years, amen, in Jesus' name, that are coming his way, full of blessing and anointing. And we are thankful for all of the membership. And we're thankful to God today for his word. We're going to get into God's word. And we're going to be looking today at the book of Psalms, Psalm 103, verses 17 and 18. Psalm 103, verses 17 and 18. This psalm is a psalm that is near to my heart. And because of that, my children have memorized it and recite it frequently. The word of God says, "But the mercy of the Lord is from everlasting to everlasting on those who fear him, and his righteousness to children's children, to such as keep his covenant and to those who remember his commandments to do them." Let's go before the Lord. Jesus, we give you praise. We give you all of the honor and glory today. We thank you for the word, Lord, that you speak. Lord, that I not speak a word, but that you would, Lord, hallelujah, declare your truth, and that our hearts would be open. In the beautiful, wonderful name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Amen. When we look at the scripture that we have just read, when we look at the words that the Lord has been merciful toward us, since when? From everlasting. Until when? Until the very end. Until beyond time. Until there is no time or space, but only everlasting. That is where God's mercy is. But it says on those who fear. That means the Lord, those that are not necessarily afraid, but to those who live in covenant with the Lord. It says his righteousness to children's children, to such as keep his covenants, that is to those who are faithful to the Lord. What is this scripture telling us? It's teaching us that the God that we serve is faithful. The God that we serve is faithful from generation to generation, from the mountain peak into the valley, in the place where it's dark, in the place where it's day. The Lord is with us through the thick and through the thin, in the good times, in the impossible times. Our God is perfect. Our God is holy. Our God does not change. He continues to be my Savior. He continues to be your deliverer. in times of sickness, in times of health, before, during, and after this pandemic is over, our God continues to be the Lord Jesus, who is the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. And because of that, I live in hope. Because of that, I live in confidence. Because of that, I live in joy. Because of that, I can celebrate every single day, because I know that the God that I serve is true. There is no lie in him. There is no evil in him. There is no darkness in him. But he is a living God, and he is faithful. He is faithful. He is faithful. Can you worship? Can you praise? Can you thank God for his faithfulness this morning? What does it mean that the Lord is faithful? It means that he is steadfast. Steadfast in affection toward his children. When I think of the word steadfast, I think of something that is locked in place. I think of something that doesn't move. I think of something that doesn't waver. I think of something that doesn't change. And because God, his faithfulness is steadfast, he has that constant affection and mercy. What else does faithfulness mean? It means that he is firm in adherence to his promises. Unlike people that we've all come across, and even us ourselves, when we give a promise to someone, we fall short. How many times have I told my children, we're going to do something, or we're going to go somewhere, and I don't come through, right? Because something that has occurred. And my kids always say, but you promised, right? They make a big deal, right? They go, you promised, you said it, so you have to do it. And so I have to find a way to meet that promise. But God is not that way. He is faithful. He comes through when he makes a promise. In fact, the word of God says in 2 Timothy 2:13, it says, if we are faithless, that means when we do not come through, that means when we don't do our part, it still says he remains faithful. He continues to be faithful. And then it says why? It says he cannot deny himself. What does that mean? That means one of the core attributes, one of the core characteristics that make the Lord our God, God, is that he is faithful, that he is true. Hallelujah. When we are untrue, he continues to be there. When we break our promises, he continues to meet them. Oh, hallelujah. This is a source of celebration to the Christian. This is a source of rejoicing, and this is a source of comfort to everyone who believes and lives for the Lord Jesus. When we look at God's word, we see many, many examples from the first book of the Bible all the way through when people don't come through, but God does. From the very first man, Adam, all the way through the time when God brought Israel out of Egyptian slavery to be their God. And we look at the time in the desert, in the time of the wilderness, in the wandering, that they, from the very beginning, they were a nation that was complaining. They were a nation that was also always quarreling. They were not satisfied, even though God, the deliverer, had been faithful the whole time. And we see that when God had just given the first inscribed with his own finger on two tablets of stone, the covenant, that when Moses was coming down the mountain, he heard noise. And we remember that that noise was because of Aaron, who had crafted an idol of gold, a calf idol, and the Israelites completely went against the Lord. We read that God was going to punish and destroy. We read that Moses fasted 40 days and 40 nights. But this was all part of God's plan, because it came to the point that God revealed himself and God revealed his heart to each and every one of us. Because the Bible says that the Lord passed in front of Moses, and it says that he stood right there and he passed in front of him. Imagine if you were there and God was right there and God proclaimed his name. He said, the Lord God, compassionate and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in mercy and truth. And the other word for truth is faithfulness. Even when they were a faithless generation, God continued to be faithful. But they, at the end, because they were time and time again in the wilderness, they continued to disobey. They continued to fall short. And the Bible says that they didn't make it, that generation, except for Joshua and Caleb, they did not make it to the promised land because they had rejected God's purpose for their life. You see, what God calls us to, he calls us into a relationship where he is a faithful God. And he has made everything possible for us to be faithful to him. And we'll get into that in a moment. Because even though Israel and throughout the Old Testament, they were a faithless nation, God still was able to bring about his promises that he made to Abraham when he told Abraham, he says, and you will be a blessing, and through you all of the families of the earth shall be blessed. Well, who is God talking about? He's talking about the Lord Jesus. God was able to bring about the plan of salvation when he declared through Isaiah, unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government will be upon his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Prince of Peace, Everlasting Father. That promise of Jesus is the promise that you and I have today. You see, despite the course of human history, from the beginning of the first man, Adam, all the way, hallelujah, man has not done their part. God has done his part. God has been faithful. But the Bible says that God demonstrated his love to us in this, that we, while we were sinners, Christ died for us. While we rejected the living God, God came to that which was his own, and his own did not receive him. But to those who received him, to those who believe on his name, just like David today, hallelujah, they shall be given the right and the privilege. You and I are given the power to become children of a God who is faithful, of a God who is true, of a God who has not only been our creator, but a God who opened the door to salvation, the one that has the promises of inheritance of eternal life for each and every one of us. God's call is a call to a nation that is going to be faithful to him. And we see even when the Lord was here, that people rejected God's purpose for their life. We see that people sought to please themselves, just like the rich young man. Remember the rich young man who came to Jesus and he asked Jesus that, you know, what he had to do to gain eternal life? And Jesus said, well, you know the law, thou shalt not murder, thou shalt not commit adultery, etc., etc. And the young man says, I've done all these things. And Jesus says, one thing you're missing. Go and sell all your possessions and give them to a poor and come and follow me. And the young man hesitated because he had a lot of dough, right? He had a lot of cash. He had a lot of investments. He had a lot in stock. And he was not willing to live a life where he put everything aside and said, God, I'm just going to be faithful to you. Lord, I'm going to put the technology aside. God, I'm going to put this relationship aside. God, I'm going to put this habit aside. God, I'm going to take this routine that I know is breaking my relationship with you. I'm going to put it aside. And today, Lord, I'm going to be faithful. Tomorrow, Lord, I'm going to be faithful. But I want to just go over three things that we talked about this morning earlier with the young people. Three things that it's important to realize that when we're living for God, when you've been washed in the blood of Jesus and you have been filled with the Holy Spirit, you have the power from God to be faithful to the living God. And it's not by my power, it's not by my might, but it's by His Spirit. It is by His Holy Spirit. That's why Romans 8:1 says, there is therefore no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, who do not walk according to the flesh, but who walk according to His Spirit. You see, I'm in point A, and I have to get to point B. That's God's purpose. I'm right here on this earth, and I have to get to heaven. Praise God. I got to get to the eternal life. But God says, well, that requires that you are faithful. For he who is faithful to the end until death will receive the crown of life. But I got to get there, God. But God is saying, you will only get there by my power. You will only get there by my strength. You will only get there with the power of that comes, hallelujah, through the anointing. You see, when you make yourself available to God, that is when God is able to work out in your heart. He is able to work out in your life. That's why Paul writes to the Philippians. He says, therefore, my beloved, as you have always obeyed, not as in my presence only, but much more in my absence, he says, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. But then he tells us how. He says, for it is God who works in you. He says, for it is God who works in you to do things, to do two things. To do his will, to will, and to do his pleasure. That means my will, God, is not going to be my will anymore. My will, Jesus, is now going to be your will. Today, Lord, the decisions that I make not by my strength. I make it because you are the one that is empowering me with your Holy Spirit to not give into temptation and to not give into a trap. Okay? Because Satan is always putting traps. He's an expert at putting traps. And the traps, you know, you cannot see them. I am not going to be able to see them. But if I'm filled with the Spirit, and how am I going to get filled with the Spirit? I have to start the day in prayer. I have to commit to fasting. I have to get on my knees. I have to have a relationship with the Lord. Because if I try to just get up and have my Cheerios and my 20 ounces of heavily caffeinated Pete's coffee, right? And I try to go to work and somebody gets me really upset, well, guess what? I'm probably not going to respond in the best way, right? But if I get up and I pray and I'm filled with the Spirit and I've read His Word and I'm meditating on His Word and I go there and somebody gets really upset, then I am going to have the power of the Holy Spirit to say, you know what? This is not this person. This is an attack from the enemy. The enemy is trying to drag me down. The enemy is trying to drag me into this temptation to lose self-control. And then at that point, I'm not going to be able to be a living testimony. But the Bible says, as I was saying this morning, when you seek your Heavenly Father in secret, He will reward you in public. Because when you are full of the Spirit, not only are you going to be able to avoid the temptation, but when the time comes for that person who is in need in that corner and is suffering, that person that is sick, God is going to open a door for you to say, you know what? I serve the living God. And you're going to have an opportunity to pray with them. And they're going to feel something, not from you, but they're going to feel something from God who is working in you. Hallelujah. To pray for them for that time of need. And then that person will be brought closer to that place where God's purpose is. Oh, church, can you worship God for His faithfulness? Because not only is He faithful, but He gives you the power to be faithful as well. God gives you the strength to overcome. One more point. Be transformed by the renewing of your mind. How am I going to be renewed every day? By meditating on God's word. Psalm 1, another favorite psalm. Blessed is the man who does not walk in the counsel of the ungodly, nor stand in the path of sinners, or sit in the seat of the mockers, but his delight is in the law of the Lord. His delight is in Scripture. His delight is in the Word of God. His delight is in the Psalms. His delight is in every word in red, every word that Jesus said. When Jesus declared to be God, when Jesus declared to be the Heavenly Father, when Jesus declared to not leave His orphans, His delight is in the Word of the living God. And in His Word, He meditates day and night. How am I going to meditate on God's Word if I haven't memorized it? And how am I going to memorize God's Word if I never take the time to read it? So when we get into His Word and we meditate on His Word becomes attached to our heart. It convicts our heart. It renews our mind so that we are ready to stand up on that day. And in Jesus' name, be ready, amen, to be able to not only defend, but so that we can move forward into other territory for the honor and glory of God.